Welcome everyone to the third session of our series. I'm Helene Bader, Senior Advisor of Education for Healthy Women, and we are so glad you are here. First, I'd like to introduce you to our organization. Healthy Women has been committed to creating and disseminating evidence-based information and clinically sound health information for women 35 to 64 for the past 30 years. And menopause is one of the topics we find is extremely important to our audience. So we developed this roundtable to answer all of your menopause questions and bring you information that you can use. Before we begin, we want to thank our sponsors. We are extremely grateful to Astellas for their generous support of this roundtable series. And we also want to thank Genev for their support as well. So today we are going to discuss pelvic health, everything below the belt. We will talk about the pelvic floor and what it is, why women should know about it, the problems women can experience, and how to prevent, manage, and treat these issues. We'll also discuss abnormal versus abnormal bleeding, tracking your bleeding, conditions that may be the cause of bleeding, and incontinence, another topic women do not want to discuss, but so many of us experience. The experts we brought together today are going to address these issues and discuss the menopause journey and how that relates to some of these symptoms. And we want to answer all of your questions, so please be sure to use the Q&A feature because we will take questions throughout the session so we can have a really rich and engaging conversation. And remember, if you missed any of our earlier sessions, please check out the videos. They are all hosted on healthywomen.org and register for our additional sessions. We'll have two more sessions in November we would love you to be a part of. And now I am thrilled to welcome our esteemed panel of experts and today's moderator, Devin Tom. Devin is the executive editor of prevention.com, and we are thrilled to have her be a part of this exciting conversation. So now I will turn it over to Devin to introduce our panelists. Thank you.
Thanks, Elaine, and thanks to you and Healthy Women for having me today. I'm so excited to be here with you all, and I will dive right in by introducing our panelists. We're gonna start with Jill. Jill Angelo is the CEO and co-founder of Genev, a first of its kind online clinic and community for women in menopause. Genev specializes in menopause and gynecology telemedicine through a team of OBGYNs and registered dietitian nutritionists. Prior to starting Genev, Jill spent 15 years at Microsoft. She is a frequent speaker on femtech, women's health, and entrepreneurship, and is also on the board of directors for Special Olympics of Washington. Then we have Dr. Sherelle B. Iglesia. She is a professor in the departments of OBGYN and urology at Georgetown University School of Medicine. She is a double board certified OBGYN and female pelvic medicine and reconstructive surgery specialist. Since 1999, Dr. Iglesia has been the inaugural director of the section of female pelvic medicine and reconstructive surgery at MedStar Washington Hospital Center / MedStar National Center for Advanced Pelvic Surgery. Dr. Iglesia is internationally recognized for advancing surgical techniques in reconstructive pelvic surgery. She has authored numerous articles and books and is the recipient of many teaching awards, but is most proud of the dozens of fellows, residents, and students she has mentored and trained over the past 20 years. And last but not least, we have Dr. Lynn Seely. She is an endocrinologist with more than 20 years of drug development and executive leadership experience. She is the chief executive officer of Myovant Scientists and a healthcare company focused on bringing innovation to women's health, particularly in the areas of uterine fibroids, endometriosis, and infertility. Prior to Myovant, she served as chief medical officer at Medivation. Dr. Seely currently serves on the board of directors of Blueprint Medicines Corporation. She completed her residency in internal medicine at Yale New Haven Hospital and a basic science and clinical fellowship in endocrinology and metabolism at the University of California, San Diego. She is a strong advocate for elevating the conversation around stigmatized women's health issues and bringing innovation to these long ignored areas. So thank you all for being here with us today. Let's start with you, Dr. Iglesia, by defining the pelvic floor. I think that's a perfect way to start off this conversation.
That's right. Well, it's really a pleasure to be here. And I've actually brought an actual pelvis so you can see from multiple angles. But when women are standing, the pelvic floor is basically anything below the belly button and between the thighs. And from an air bird's eye view, the pelvis is made up of these muscles and the nerves that innervate the muscles and the connective tissue that support the main organs, mostly the urethra, the bladder, the vagina, the cervix, uterus, and then the rectum and anus. So there's a lot of form and function that we need to be aware of when we think of the pelvis, which in Latin means bowl. Pelvis is a bowl or basin. So this is like the bowl for your bottom. And on this view, which is what we would see when you're in stirrups, you can see how this is a very vulnerable part of the body, particularly with gravity and as babies are coming out of the birth canal, that some of these muscles and connective tissue and the nerves can get damaged and tears can occur that can lead to the main pelvic support problems leading to prolapse, urinary and bowel incontinence, and even some minor nuances like vaginal laxity and light bladder leakage and accidental bowel leakage, all of which can affect a woman's quality of life and lead to social isolation, embarrassment, and really just they're just so ashamed that they don't even want to bring it up with their doctor. So this is very common. One out of three women in their 50s. So this is the range of healthy women, but even in your 40s and younger, one out of four can have a pelvic floor disorder. And by the time you're 80, it's half of women, 80% have some kind of pelvic floor disorder. So one out of two by the time you're 80. So it's extremely common. Unfortunately, it's something that's not really understood. And there's a lot of myths. And I know, Devin, you're going to ask some questions about that, because there's so much on social media, you know, about vaginal rejuvenation and cosmetic gynecology. And I think it's going to be important that we have the conversation to know, like, what's reconstructive, what's bona fide, what are sort of ancillary procedures that may not have as much science behind them, but certainly they're emerging technologies that sort of need to be explored. So I know there'll be a lot of questions. I'm looking forward to answering them if I can.
Absolutely. I'm sure you're going to answer them all just great, Cheryl. So Jill, let's go over to you. What's one thing about menopause in general that you didn't know before, but now with your work with Genev, you're glad you know now?
Yeah, it's a great question. With Genev, the whole reason why we created Genev as really an online kind of destination for women to get educated on menopause and then to get the care that they need if they don't have a doctor or access to someone that can really help them with their symptom relief. When we started the company almost 4 years ago, we surveyed 1,500 women to just understand how did they get educated on menopause, which is something every woman goes through. And overwhelmingly, the respondents came back and said, I wasn't educated. I was so unprepared. Just start the conversation. And it kind of goes back to, I think even in Lynn's intro, talking about destigmatizing and just making women more comfortable with this time of our lives. And so that really goes to the heart. Our mission at Genev is to empower women to take control of their health in menopause. And so based on that feedback from women, we were selling, over-the-counter products like lubricants for vaginal dryness, as well as supplements and hygiene products, all geared towards symptoms and menopause. But based on that research, we also started publishing content. And, there's a number of different resources that women can go to, but we wanted to be a platform that spoke in a consumer voice, but also was evidence-based care and backed by health providers that reviewed our content. So we just started interviewing physicians and experts like Cheryl and Lynn, who are working with these women in the medical field, to bring that knowledge to women. Some of the things I've learned you know, I'm in perimenopause myself, so I'm building a company that is focused on a lot of Gen X women as well as boomer, baby boomer women. But in particular, you know, there's 34 different symptoms of menopause, and the pelvic floor and some of the symptoms associated with that part of menopause that we're talking about today is just a fraction of so many things that women go through. And I guess what I learned most was how broad reaching the hormonal changes that are happening in a woman's body during menopause impact us in so many ways, whether it is, you know, pelvic floor health and vaginal pain and vaginal laxity or even just, you know, atrophy all the way to things like heart palpitations, you know, the traditional hot flashes, but joint pain and fatigue, weight gain. We hear a lot about those symptoms from women as well that we hope to be a resource that we can either direct them to the right professionals or answer their questions for them.
Thank you. So, you know, you mentioned perimenopause. I had not known that such a thing existed until I got to prevention. So Lynn, I'd love to talk to you about, you know, and Jill, you mentioned all these symptoms, a list of just 34 to start with. I'm going to pick abnormal bleeding. Lynn, how can you tell if your abnormal bleeding is something that maybe is due to perimenopause or if it's perhaps endometriosis, fibroids? Can you speak to that?
Sure. So I think it's so interesting because we talk about normal periods and normal cycles as if everybody understands exactly what that means. But the fact of the matter is, most women don't even know what normal bleeding is, what a normal period is. And so therefore, they don't know what abnormal is and when to seek help from a physician or a healthcare provider. And one of the things that happens over time, and particularly as we age, is that your periods start to change and maybe your bleeding is becoming heavier or more irregular. And women tend to normalize this and just say, oh, I must be getting older. This is just a normal part of aging. When in fact, that's oftentimes not the case because there are many other things which can cause abnormal bleeding or heavier bleeding. And so when you look at what is abnormal uterine bleeding or abnormal menstrual bleeding, it really is menstrual bleeding that is abnormal in quantity, in duration, or in schedule. And what does abnormal mean? It means abnormal for you. And so it's certainly possible that you're moving into the perimenopause time. And what does that mean? Menopause is the cessation of ovarian function and is associated with low levels of estrogen. But this doesn't happen overnight. Ovarian function gradually peters out over time. And so for 3 to 5 years on average, women can experience some changes in their period, heavier bleeding, sometimes lighter or irregular bleeding. And that could be from perimenopause, but it also could be from other things. And so I think one of the key things that we're here to talk about is to encourage women, if they are seeing changes in their periods or symptoms from that may be associated with menopause, but maybe something else, to seek out healthcare advice. And I'll give you an example. It's very common as women age also to get symptomatic uterine fibroids. So what are uterine fibroids? They're benign tumors that grow in and on the walls of the uterus, and they can cause heavy bleeding. And it's something that can come on gradually over time. It's particularly common in African American women, and it's treated differently than perimenopause. There are treatments available for it. So these are some things to consider that if you're sensing a change in your periods, to really seek advice and talk to your healthcare provider about it.
Great. And Sherelle, do you have anything to add about abnormal bleeding? I know it's a broad topic, but before we move on to other issues, sure. I wanted to give you the chance to weigh in on that.
Yeah, and, you know, there's a whole mnemonic, it's called Palm Coin, that looks at different types of abnormal bleeding, and a lot of it's based on age. So like, if you're young and you just started having your period and you're going into getting blood transfusions, you know, that's where you work up coagulopathy. So people who have problems with their livers and with making blood clot, and that can happen. A common thing is von Willebrand's, and like women, I mean, young girls who are 12 and 13 are having heavy bleeding and having to be transfused. As you get older, I mean, obviously the first thing in reproductive age women is to make sure for abnormal that you're not pregnant, because that would be a completely different workup. And then as you reach into the perimenopause and say it's not related to hormonal contraception, which in and of itself is related to different abnormal cycles, in the perimenopause, which is really over a 7-year period from the time that to the very a year from your last period when the very last egg is released for ovulation, and that's it. The ovaries are not functioning anymore in releasing their follicles. But there's a large array. Lynn mentioned fibroids, but you could have uterine polyps. You can have another condition known as adenomyosis. That's where the lining of the uterus, which should be thin and should be definitely, you know, in postmenopausal women under 5 millimeters. But if that lining kind of builds into the wall of the muscle of the uterus, you can have a lot of bleeding and a lot of painful bleeding because like the whole uterus is bleeding at that point. Polyps or the small growths are usually smaller than fibroids, but fibroids are a very large reason why people have abnormal bleeding. And as she said, 80% of African-American women probably have fibroids. I think Kamala Harris is throwing a lot of money, thank God, to the NIH is proposing research for funding because fibroids are so big. And that's where the muscle itself can grow and start to get bigger than the original size of the uterus. And they can become parasitic fibroids that can pedunculate. They look like Mickey Mouse ears. They can grow on other abnormal parts of the body, like into the vagina itself, on the cervix, into the abdominal cavity, and start to wreak some havoc. In addition to the fibroids, which can grow a lot of other places, obviously cancer becomes an issue when someone has heavy abnormal uterine bleeding, particularly after the menopause. So after the menopause, no bleeding for 1 year. You start bleeding again, you know, that could be related to a very thin lining because too little hormone can bleed as well. It just bleeds just by looking at it. You know, you have sex and it bleeds. And we can talk about that. I think there's other videos that have been done, well, other webinars on that topic, maybe like 2 webinars ago with healthy women. But cancer needs to be on that differential because you don't want to miss a uterine cancer. So when linings thicken, and then they start to convert to become uterine cancer, then that's a concern. And in a very small percentage, it's something like 1 in 350 or 1 in 7,000 women who have fibroids, they can be a cancer. It's way less than 1%. They can become a very aggressive form of cancer known as a sarcoma. And for those who know about this, you know, that was in the news several years ago with the morcellation of the uterus when they were chopping it up and releasing cancerous cells into the abdomen because they didn't recognize that that fibroid was actually a cancer. So it takes a lot of very clear history, knowing the age, knowing the risk factors, diabetes, hypertension, for example, are risk factors for cancer, and just a good physical exam. And of course, for me, prolapse. We're going back to the pelvic floor, but that's what happens when the uterus and the bladder and all the organs start to sag into the vagina. And that can cause some friction, some rubbing, and that can cause some bleeding. Obviously, there's other cancers like cervical cancer. I think there's another segment here on HPV, and people should get HPV vaccinations before the age. You know, I think it's right now it's up to like age 42, I think. But that's a good thing to do for prevention of cervical cancer. I'm way past that age. We missed that boat being not a Gen Xer, but a boomer. But the bottom line is, the differential is broad and it's age-based and risk factor-based, and you need a good clinician who can do a good physical exam.
And I think just to build on that, because I think it's so important for women to understand that, you know, a very common experience would be, and this happens lots and lots, just for example, there are 5 million women in the US suffering from symptomatic uterine fibroids. And so what will happen as a woman ages, her periods gradually increase. She's starting to bleed more and more. She's using more and more menstrual products. Maybe she's got a change of clothes, you know, in a gym bag in case she bleeds through her clothes. She's staining her sheets. She's starting to develop social anxiety. And all this time, she's thinking, well, I'm just getting older, this is aging, and she's getting more fatigued and more tired and more attributing this just to aging. And finally, when she advocates for herself and actually takes time out to get evaluated, she goes to the doctor and gets that evaluation and finds out that she's anemic. Her blood counts are very, very low from this long-term bleeding. And all of this could have been avoided if, as she's tracking her periods and collecting data, she talks to her physician about these changes. So I think this idea of, if you're sensing changes in your body, if your bleeding is changing, your periods are changing, you're developing other things like incontinence or painful intercourse, talk about it to your physician, because many of these conditions can be managed.
So Lynn, that's
the other way around though, Lynn, because I had a coworker, I mean, we're gynecologists and she's our coworker, and she was seeing a cardiologist because her heart rate was so fast and her blood pressure was so low, and nobody asked her about her abnormal bleeding. They put a halter monitor on her till I saw her, and she's African-American. And I'm like, you look really pale. What? I found out that she had a transfusion and she's being worked up, and no one really, that was it. It was just crazy to me that you would just talk your way out of this as a normal part of aging.
We are taught not to talk about our periods. We're taught to just deal with it, whatever comes, and it's not right. And so that's why we're here, to really empower women to identify, talk about, and raise their symptoms so that they can get the help and education they need.
Which is why it's so nice that you have this site, Jill, so that people can get some legitimate information in a way that, you know, probably is a little bit less stigmatized, and you can answer, ask some questions about bladder leakage and abnormal bleeding and fibroids and sexual dysfunction as well. Because, you know, having these issues where you are leaking urine or gas, or you have the prolapse and you've had someone who says, oh, it's not as tight, it's different since I've had my baby, I feel loose, a vagina's making noises when I'm having sex, and what's going on, and now I don't want to have the sex because I feel shamed. Having a site like that is very useful, because I think that people can ask these questions, healthy women the same way, being able to ask these questions to be able to normalize it and figure out, you know, what we can do about it, because yeah, we can do a lot about it.
You know, the majority of women who find Genev really come because they're just searching online, you know, for answers, because it's discreet. And I think that point around normalizing things is such an important aspect of all the work that we do. I think commonly women kind of think that heavy bleeding, as you're talking about, is just normal. And so we're not taught to think any different. So why would we even ask or look it up? And so I think it goes way back even around what is normal, and really kind of like, well, kind of nothing is. I think it also, we have to impart on women and even young girls to just explore and understand our health to a deeper degree than we're taught to, you know.
So this is a great segue into our first question from the audience. And I'm going to direct it to you, Sherelle. We're going to try to get a little bit more definitive here around what heavy bleeding is. They ask, how can I talk to my doctor about my heavy bleeding? I am not sure what heavy bleeding means and want to have a productive conversation with my doctor.
Sure. So heavy menstrual bleeding can be that it's a single, your period that's heavy and you're using more tampons and more pads, or you're bleeding on a regular basis, like you start bleeding and it's not time for your period, and that's abnormal bleeding as well. You don't want to get down like my coworker did to a hemoglobin, you know, to full-blown anemia. But I think you should have a sense of, and they have so many of these trackers, and there's apps available, and I'm sure, Jill, you can mention some of these apps where you can actually, and Lynn, you can mention it too, track your menstrual cycle and say what's heavy, and you can shade that heavier, what's just spotting. So is it just heavy for like 2 days, or is it heavy for 5 days? But then I have spotting for 7. You know, it could be that you had your regular period, the lining shed, now that fibroid and that polyp is bleeding. So I think you need to understand that there could be not just hormonal issues, but structural abnormalities, fibroids and polyps, endometriosis itself, that can be leading to this, to the problems of heavy bleeding. Certainly, if you start to develop shortness of breath, low blood pressure, syncope, which means you're fainting, very fast heart rate, you look pale, and your eyelids are very light, not dark red, which is, I could see that from the room, from opposite room from my coworker, or your nail beds start to get really light. That's, those are like the signs of pretty significant anemia. We don't want to get to that route. You should know what's normal for you and then what becomes abnormal, whether it's longer in the cycle, you're using more pads, or longer duration.
Maybe I can add to that, because I think it's such an important question. It gets back to this fundamentally, women don't know. And it's very interesting that even the medical groups have now said that anything that is, any bleeding that is impacting your physical, social, emotional, or overall quality of life is abnormal. That is now the accepted definition. So abnormal for you, that's impacting you in a negative way. Now, if you look at the formal definition, blood loss in a cycle, a normal period that's more than 80 mLs is abnormal. Well, women don't go around measuring their blood loss in a measuring cup. They don't even know what 80 mLs is. For your information, it's 6 tablespoons is abnormal during a cycle. On average, women bleed about 30 to 40 mLs, or about 3 to 4 tablespoons. But what is important is, if it's impacting you physically, socially, emotionally, or decreasing your quality of life, that's worth a conversation with your physician. And you were asking about tracking, and it's so important because doctors like data, right? And you, so if you come prepared and you've collected how many pads and tampons, or how frequently you're emptying your menstrual cup, how much you're staining, how heavy and saturated your products are, that can be really useful. And now my Advanced Sciences, we've partnered with Flow, which is a leading health app for women that actually has a wonderful period tracker where you can actually track your heavy menstrual bleeding. We worked with them to develop a tool so women can start to know what's normal and abnormal and have the language and get a report to actually use with their physicians. So data is powerful. If you're, you know, you don't know, collect the data for yourself and then take it and talk to your healthcare provider. That's the most important thing I can say.
That's great, Lynn. And would you mind just repeating the name of that app in case people do want to download it?
Yeah, I would definitely take a look. It's got such valuable content. It's called Flow, F-L-O. And it's one of the leading women's health, or probably the leading women's health app. They've got more than 36 million users and a lot of great content.
That's great. Okay, so I want to move on to another important topic we're here to talk about today, which is incontinence. Yep. And I'm bringing it over to you again, Sherelle, because you enlightened me when we talked last about a new buzzword for it. So maybe you can share that with us as you're answering this question. And the question is, what are types of incontinence? And is it normal to experience this even during the perimenopause years?
Okay, ladies, then the new buzzword, because I think it's easier to say than urinary incontinence, is light bladder leakage. But some of us know that it's not always just light and we're gushing. So there are three main types of bladder leakage or urinary incontinence. And we can talk about fecal, that, or save that for another day. But basically, 80% of women who 20% of women who have urinary incontinence also have dual incontinence, so they'll have incontinence of bowel, and that's another big problem. But for the 80, for those women, you know, now by the time you're 80, 50% of women have some problems with bladder control. The three main subtypes are stress urinary incontinence. That's the leakage with cough, laugh, and sneeze, usually due to either weak pelvic floor muscles or tears in the connective tissue supports of the bladder neck, which is the where the urethra connects to the bladder. There can also be direct nerve damage from having children. And having children and just actually even being pregnant is one of the biggest risk factors for incontinence. And incontinence, as stress incontinence, is more common in the younger part of the perimenopause, like the 30s, 40s. And then once you get into your 50s, 60s, 70s, urge incontinence, which is the other form of incontinence where you gotta go and can't make it to the bathroom in time, predominates. That gets more common as you age. And then the other kind that you can have is mixed, which is a bad combination of both. And when we're treating that, both the urge and the stress, it really takes an astute clinician to figure out how much of that urge is related to the lack of support to the bladder? And how can we fix this? Is this a surgical thing? Can we just work on physical therapy and Kegel exercises? When do we use medications? And by the way, ladies, medications have gotten a bad rap lately because some of them can affect the brain and cross the blood-brain barrier and lead to some cognitive impairment, particularly as you get older and you can't metabolize those medicines. But it takes an astute clinician to do the exam to figure out how much your muscles contribute, how much of this is a connective tissue or sphincter problem, and how much is it a nerve problem, which now, ladies, we even have Botox for the bladder, and we can get Botox, not use any medications at all. There's all these new pacemakers that we have that are now MRI compatible and super small. So there's a lot of technology. We just need to start talking about it, kind of like tracking it. We've got diaries for that as well. the American Urogyn Society has the Voices for Pelvic Floor Disorders, voicesforpfd.org, and there's diaries and stuff. And I'm sure you may have something on Geneve as well. But this is something that the diaries are helpful for us to see. Obviously, if you're over drinking, you're going to urinate a lot more. And so overactive bladder is due to the fact that you're drinking 3 liters a day, not necessarily due to overactivity, because what goes in comes out. So I think the main forms are stress incontinence, urge incontinence, mixed, and a very small percentage of people, they don't empty well at all. Usually that's due to like a too tight repair or a neurological condition like Parkinson's or MS, and you can get overflow incontinence. But that's a little bit the minority or the overflow type. So it's gonna take an astute clinician and some easy things to do. And when we're talking about menopause, if you have very dry connective tissue and vaginal atrophy or vaginal dryness, because the vagina, the urethra, and the bladder come from the same embryological origin, you can actually eliminate some of that urgency just by treating the local low estrogen levels within the vagina. So there's a lot of things you can do that don't necessarily need surgery.
And the one thing I want to say about incontinence is doctors often don't ask about it. And women have a tendency to think, well, the doctor didn't ask about it, so it must not be important enough to speak about. And because you're a little bit embarrassed or intimidated anyway. But I would tell you, don't wait to be asked about it. Raise your symptoms. So if you're having incontinence, you know, the doctor may not want to talk about it, but you need to raise it so that if that's not the right physician for you, maybe they can refer you to somebody who is comfortable in addressing it. So I think this is another one of those hidden symptoms that women are suffering from in large numbers, and yet they don't often raise to their physician unless they're seeing Dr. Iglesia, sorry, who asked about it.
There are doctors who will say, well, what do you expect, Mary? You're getting older, and just kind of poo-poo. And I say, that's when you divorce your gynecologist.
if they're not listening to your symptoms and taking you seriously, get someone who will.
Well, and I think to that point, we often get women who come to Geneve and ask, what should I be asking my gynecologist? And I think the importance of going in prepared to that appointment with a list of questions or a list of the things that you're experiencing is key, because you have a finite amount of time with that practitioner. And so really being prepared with your list of questions, that's one thing. If women come to Geneve.com, they can take our menopause assessment, which is kind of a quiz that just asks you about a number of symptoms you might be experiencing. And I think to your point, Lynn, oftentimes women don't think about, oh, yeah, urinary incontinence is something I'm experiencing. I should put that down as a symptom that I should talk to my physician about. And I think that it just doesn't come to women's, you know, top of mind when you're going into the doctor. So prepare for that visit with everything that, you know, with your list of questions. And if you need to kind of think through what are all these different symptoms I might be experiencing, take something like the menopause assessment at Geneve or sit down and look at, you know, just kind of do a little bit of an audit on how you're feeling before you go in to talk to him or her for your appointment.
You know, that's great. And doctors like data, right? So the questions are important, but then define those symptoms. How often, how frequently, how is it impacting your life negatively? So if you actually bring data, it's easier for the doctor to sort of engage with your symptoms, I find.
And you know what's interesting, because we were talking about pads, Lynn and Jill, and did you know that there are more pads being sold and bought for bladder leakage than there are for bleeding? That's how big and bad this problem is. And so women are wearing the pads and they're not seeking the treatments that could be effective to eliminate the pads. So the average person is probably waiting 5 years to seek because they're so embarrassed by it. And then they may be socially isolating. They're not gonna go on that trampoline. They're not gonna go pick up that grandchild. They're gonna, you know, they're afraid sometimes even to go to a temple or a place of worship or church because they're afraid they're gonna smell. And if I had a penny for every time someone, you know, had this, like, why did I see you sooner? You made such a difference. It makes you a little bit sad. And I'm not sure if it's because we're supposed to be like, you know, sexy women, and this is not sexy. And this is not like, you know, we can't admit that we have this problem. I'm not sure, but there's definitely some stigma related to this. And the fact that, you know, people are ashamed. So they're just going to wear the pads and carry on and try and keep calm about it. But I'm thinking you can reverse it.
So Cheryl, you mentioned pads is something a lot of women use. Another member of the audience is asking, I'm seeing ads for EMS devices for treatment of OAB. They are expensive. And so I'm wondering if they truly work. I'm sure all of you have thoughts about this, but Jill, I want to start with you. I'm curious if you've heard anything about EMS devices at Geneve and what your thoughts are.
You know, we certainly have, you know, a lot of being kind of a women's health platform, a lot of different either device or product companies will come to us and just ask us to share information about their product. And I think, you know, at the end of the day, there's so many different solutions for women. And so we're never in the place to say this works and this doesn't. But I certainly, we always go back to evidence-based care. And if there are, you know, both proven kind of stats or experiences or clinical research behind a device or behind a procedure, that's always where we push women to the most if we're going to recommend anything. So certainly look at, you know, the data behind it. You know, is it used? Has it gone through any kind of clinical testing? It doesn't have to be 100%, you know, with a big clinical study. But I think that in order to understand if a device is going to be effective, look at its background and the research and how it's been used. So in terms of us endorsing anyone, we're very careful about how we get behind any device or product. But I think there's some great innovation in this area. And I'm glad companies and different businesses and brands are exploring it, because women's health needs more of this. And as long as we're using research to back up what we're developing, that's just important as a consumer for women to look at the options that are available to her. And then, of course, take it and ask your doctor about it. And your doctor might not have heard of every device or every product or brand out there, but use your physician, whether it's your doctor or, you know, again, we've got a team of telehealth doctors at Geneve, that even over a video chat, you can ask them these kinds of questions that doesn't require a physical examination. Obviously, we can't do the physical examination, but if you want some advice and guidance, you certainly can use resources to just get that kind of feedback.
Lynn, do you have any thoughts there on these devices?
So certainly it's not my expertise, and I agree 100% with what Jill said. I'm delighted always to see innovation in women's health areas, because so many of these diseases have been underserved, and the way you need to evaluate them is with data. And I think exploring yourself and working with your healthcare provider to find solutions that are right for you, because the one thing we know about women is they're a wide range, and we need sort of personalized treatments for each woman. And so what's right for a woman is really dependent upon her specific situation. So Cheryl, maybe you should comment.
Yeah, unfortunately, I do think that there's not always truth in advertising. And so everything that Jill was saying is true. And when you see something that says, oh, this is a device that's going to improve your sex life, and you can sit in this magnetic chair and you'll get three sessions for $2,000 and you're going to be like you're 21 again and you can throw away all your pads, I would be skeptical. So, I mean, I'm here in Washington, D.C. I have served on 5 different panels for the FDA, so I know a little bit about OBGYN devices. And the FDA is pretty strict about how things are marketed, because I think that in the past, there have been some devices related to energy-based devices, lasers, radio frequency wands, et cetera, that have advertised for certain indications. And honestly, there was no data to back that up. So be careful. I like to look at the same way you were saying, no, I love innovation, but I would say no innovation without evaluation. So we need to not only just evaluate that product, understanding who's supporting that, just in terms of understanding if there could be a bias. It's always nice to have a comparator, whether that just be working on Kegels or a surgical repair or other physical therapy that we're doing. Weight loss in and of itself, you know, because a lot of times for drugs, even devices, particularly those that you've paid a lot of money, there's large placebo effects. And so we just need to be aware of that so that we're not just not propagating something that really has minimal value and may even potentially have some harm.
Sure. Thank you all for answering that question. Another one from an audience member. I'm a DES daughter approaching 70, menopause at 52, 1 pregnancy, a C-section. I've had hot flashes and other symptoms for over 20 years. There isn't much in the literature about DES and menopause though. Have you noticed anything clinically? We'll start with you, Sherelle.
Yeah, so DES stands for diethylstilbestrol, and you can know about this more, Lynn, than I, but it used to be a drug that was given to pregnant women to help prevent preterm labor. And it turned out that in the daughters of the women who took that, and so now many of them are now in the menopause, because this is back in the 50s, end up having higher rates of cervical, vaginal, and uterine anomalies, as well as risks for cervical and vaginal cancers. So DES women who are now entering the menopause, you know, we've changed guidelines that you don't need to take pap smears to every 5 years, particularly if you have the HPV, and you can stop at 65, et cetera, if you don't have a risk factor. But if you're a DES patient, you cannot follow those guidelines. You actually need exams every year and pap smears every year because of the risk for that, particularly vaginal cancer. Even if you get a hysterectomy, you still need a pap smear and an exam every year. And because of some of the abnormalities with the way the cervix or the uterus can be shaped, it can lead to abnormal bleeding to some degree and even prolapse. So we have a large series of DS patients that we've operated on, and a lot of them have shortened vaginas, and there's different ways that you can approach surgery in that patient. So I would definitely go to someone who is experienced in handling DS patients because of the risk for higher risk for particularly vaginal cancers. But in terms of your hormones, like your ovaries, that does not impact it. So your ovarian function and reserve and testosterone should be pretty similar. It's mostly the vagina, cervix, and uterus, what we call the Müllerian anomalies, that are impacted with DES. Did I miss anything, Lynn? I mean,
No, I'm not. I don't know of any relationship with hot flashes. And the only thing I would say about hot flashes is there's a lot of research going on right now for new treatments in addition to estrogens, which are known to be very effective. But there are some newer treatments which are undergoing development and clinical trials, which may be very effective to treat the thermoregulatory center in women. So that's an important new menopausal area of investigation that's coming, but they're not yet approved.
So Sherelle, I know you mentioned at the beginning about cosmetic surgeries. There's lots of misinformation out there around cosmetic surgeries in the vaginal area. And so I'd love to, you know, now that we have around 10 minutes left, I wanna make sure we get on that topic. What are some of the number one takeaways you want to tell women in this chat to be aware of with these surgeries?
Well, I don't take surgery lightly. And I think that cosmetic gynecology has a broad range. I mean, there's, first of all, the whole field of what the vulva looks like, the fact that probably 80% of boomers are doing some kind of grooming, and 80% of Gen Xers, millennials, and like 34%, I think, of the boomers are doing some kind of grooming. People have a better view of what the labia look like, and they have a certain misinformation, particularly with regards to like what we see in pornography and what we just see in even mainstream media, what this labia and the vulva should look like, which is not a Barbie doll. So many people think it's abnormal when the labia minora, and that's because, so they're clipping this, they're getting wands, they're getting lasers to shrink the labia and to do things around the clitoris. And I just caution people because, you know, particularly young women, and it's normal. And then as you get older, you know, the lips actually recede, just like these lips would. Things get smaller, and you have to be careful about cutting, particularly, you know, and doing these cosmetic procedures on the labia and the mons and the clitoris. Okay, number two, that prolapse, which is really when the organs drop. So there's different degrees. You go from 0 to 4. 0 is normal, and 4 is like everything's falling all the way out. Most women have some form of prolapse, and then they call that laxity. And so there's been lots of different wands and lasers that are used to shrink those tissues. And then lasers, when the vagina is dry, to expand the tissues. Again, we need to balance that because a lot of the data hasn't been balanced on the tried and true things that we know work, like local estrogens, moisturizers, also lubricants, also pelvic floor muscle exercises, weight loss. Going through these cosmetic procedures, which can cost thousands of dollars and are not covered by insurance, when we have bona fide, and at the end of the day, I'm a reconstructive pelvic surgeon, takes insurance that can cover all this stuff, so you're not paying out of pocket. And unfortunately, I've seen it where women have been duped. She has stage 3 prolapse. Someone said, I can put this laser in there. It's going to cost $2,000. You're going to get all better. And it didn't do anything. And we did reconstructive surgery. She went home the next day and she's like, why didn't anybody tell me about this? I think some of it is due to the fact that people are worried about the mesh, and that's gotten a bad rap. And certainly there were some meshes that were for slings and for prolapse that were less than ideal. And some of them are no longer being made. But again, I think you need to go to someone who's doing high volume, who's aware of the science, who's, you know, and doing a lot of surgery and not, and offering you a panoply. If everyone's just going to give you one thing and not offer a lot of alternatives, I would be like shaking my head a little bit.
I think you covered it so well, Cheryl. I learned a lot in that whole explanation. But, you know, what I love is that you break it down for women in starting with, you can start with a lubricant or, you know, a local estrogen before you would consider something more extreme. And I don't think that, you know, women necessarily hear that, or they've maybe tried it, but not under, you know, kind of the advice of a physician like you. So I just have to say, I love how you stair step through all the different options because there are so many.
And I just want to echo that because each woman is unique, and you shouldn't, if you're told there's just one option for whatever it is you're struggling with, you want to make sure you take the time to research and really look at all the different options and then have a discussion with your physician about what might be best for you. And so spending some time and actually educating yourself and then having a good conversation with your physician or through a telemedicine appointment in this time of COVID, more important than ever, it can be so helpful. And so this idea that just jump to the first thing that you see on some advertisement or something that sounds new and exciting and expensive may not be the right answer. So I really like this idea of women have got to educate themselves and then speak to their physician.
You know, and I think that like fibroids is another example. So we have 4 subspecialties. There's GYN oncology, high risk obstetrics, minimally invasive gynecology, and reproductive endocrinology, there's five, and then female pelvic medicine and reconstructive surgery. But minimally invasive gynecologists do probably the most fibroids, and a lot of them who are doing a lot of surgery should offer you the non-surgical treatments, because you know what? It might not be that you need a hysterectomy. Sometimes you can just remove the one offending fibroid, and sometimes you can do it through the cervix and have no incision at all. Sometimes you can just shut down the blood supply to that certain fibroid. Sometimes you can use medicines and avoid surgery to shrink things at all. They also can astutely kind of do the right examination and MRIs or sonograms, whatever is needed, to see if you're in that one out of 350 or one out of 7,000 that potentially could have the, you know, precancerous stuff. So I think that's important. Seeing a minimally invasive gynecologic surgeon who's a high volume center who can offer the panoply of conservative and surgical treatment. Same thing for reconstructive surgery. Why are you going to your plastic surgeon or dermatologist to talk about your lips and your incontinence? And trust me, they're all advertising it because they've got lasers to take your tattoos off and these brown spots on my face. But, you know, maybe they're not the best equipped person to deal with the pelvic floor. And maybe there's this incentive to use something other than tried and true treatments.
And I think this idea of really, you know, there are 350,000 hysterectomies performed in women in the US every year. That is a staggering number. And there are more and more alternatives for that. It's something my advanced sciences is working on to develop new medicines that can be used over the long term for women with heavy menstrual bleeding for uterine fibroids, for example. So a one pill once a day treatment that can be an alternative. And so this is why, again, it's so important, whether it's incontinence or reconstructive surgery or uterine fibroids, that you really understand your options before you make a decision, particularly something like hysterectomy, which is an operation which can't be undone.
That's right.
Someone commented, the practice of cosmetic gynecology seems intended to benefit straight men, not women. So just thought I would share that.
I feel like we're all allies, LGBTQ+, right?
So we only have about a minute or two left. So I'd love to just end with a final thought that you would like to share with the group here. Lynn, let's start with you.
100% of women go through menopause. There are symptoms associated with menopause. It's normal. Speak up, speak out, and get the advice and help you need.
Jill?
You know, I think at the end of the day, beyond, you know, just knowing that what you're going through is normal and that you should seek out help, also, you know, ask other, like, get involved with communities. There's a lot, you know, even not to promote just Genev.com, but there's a lot of online communities of women going through change. And sometimes that also helps normalize it. If you're going through a lot of challenges, to hear from other women going through changes just makes it less lonely. Five of seven patients that we have from a telemedicine perspective lately are just really lonely and dealing with isolation right now. Obviously 2020 has presented a lot of isolation to a lot of women, but seek out community in addition to talking to health providers. It just helps you feel like you're not in it alone and that it's much more normal than you think it is.
Okay, I'm going to say I'm going to be preventative, and I want people to take their pelvic floor in their own hands and take control. It's beyond Kegels here I'm talking about. I'm talking about your sex life. I'm talking about your bladder function, your bowel function, your bleeding, if it's abnormal or not. You need to just own it and say, it's bothering me. Talk to your doctor or your other, nurse practitioner, PAs, a healthcare provider. And if you don't think you're getting the respect you need to, or the right answers, or they're just kind of blowing you off, seek some more help. Because I honestly feel that there is a power in the sisterhood. So what you're talking about, Jill, with the community, what you're talking about with healthy women, I really don't advertise a lot of my patients, for my services. And I feel like I get a lot of patients either from, you know, mother, sisters. I'm that old now that I can get the daughters of the mothers I've operated on 20 years ago. But I also from the friends, people talk, apparently they talk to their hairdressers and their gynecologists. But, you know, it's just important that you're able to be able to speak freely about this, because you should be living your best life in menopause. I mean, we should be having great sex. We don't have to worry about, you know, getting pregnant anymore. And, you know, we shouldn't be worrying about leaking during sex. We shouldn't be worrying about making noises during sex, unless you want to, you know, and you shouldn't be worrying about it hurting or having the dryness. And you know, I think the stigma, and certainly I'm a big advocate against, you know, violence against women, all the images against women that are trying to put it into what the perfect vagina is supposed to look like. You know, I'm all against, I'm about the whole diversity of the vulva and the vagina. There isn't one particular look that you have to be. It's nice to have, look, we're all diverse on our faces. It's important for us to be diverse down there too. That was a lot.
Amen. Well, this has been such a great discussion. Thanks to all three of you and Healthy Women for giving us all this opportunity. I just want to remind everyone that you can join Healthy Women for their next of two sessions in this series, one on chronic conditions on November 4th, and the final session on November 18th is about sex, so that could be a fun one. Register at healthywomen.org. And that's it. Thank you all again so much. This, I learned a lot, and it was a pleasure. So
thank you.
Be well, everyone. Take care.